morning, everybody. How's everybody doing today? Good. So yeah, this is a great turnout. It's fabulous. So I want to introduce myself. I'm Chris Perkins. I'm a human resources site lead out at Point Magoo. So we'll try not to speak in acronyms, but when you work for the Department of Navy, that's what you'll learn right off the bat. There's all sorts of acronyms. So if you don't understand something, have a question, raise your hand, yell out, and we'll try to catch it. So I want to introduce folks that came along with me. Angel Zamoron from our Pathways Program Manager from the Weapons Center out at China Lake. And Tony Strickland, he's our HR advisor here at Point Magoo. And then Ms. Lisa Alonzo from our PEO office. She manages our special emphasis programs at Point Magoo. So great that you're out here. I'm a Ventura College alum, so don't hold that against me. I went to Ventura College, grew up in Camarillo, went on to UCSB to get a degree in political science. Started out in Point Magoo back in 1984. What we wanted to do today was come out and talk a little bit about internship opportunities we have through the Pathways program, and talk a little bit about the mechanics of getting a resume together and getting into the system. So Angel's going to talk about the Pathways program, and then Tony's going to talk about USA Jobs and resumes and how to get in that. He is a Pathways hire for us a few years ago, so he's got firsthand experience in navigating some of that. The real reason we're out here is we recruit nationwide for engineers. We go to campuses throughout California, across the nation. It's very expensive for people to move here, and particularly when you're coming out of college and you have student debt. So we want to reach out to the local community. Many of you born and raised here. Many of you may have family and plans to stay in this area. So to us, it's a win-win to capture, you know, qualified engineering grads, computer science grads to come work for us. So we're excited about setting up a partnership with the college. This is the first time I think we've been out here. So I'm hoping it's the first of some other many visits we can. So I'm going to kick it off to Angel. And if you do have any questions, so they can catch the question in back, try to speak up so we can capture your question along with what we have to tell you today. Thanks.
So as Chris said, I'm Angel Zamoron. I'm the Pathways Program Manager for NOPWD, which is the Naval Air Warfare Center Weapons Division. Covers both sites, China Lake and Point Magoo, California. Not sure if anyone's familiar with China Lake, which is the sister site to the global base here. We're up north, kind of halfway between LA and Mammoth, totally off to the side. Most people don't know where I come from, so just wanted to give everyone a little idea of our local geography here. So what I'm here to talk to you about today is the Pathways Intern Program, which is actually a national, federal internship option for employment with the government. And the program is called Pathways, and it's got several different sections of it, but what I'm here to talk about is the intern program, which is a program that's designed to kind of integrate your school education and capabilities and everything that you're learning with some real-time work experience that's valuable to both you as a student and your future career, and provides value to the command that you work for as well. So basically what it is a paid working internship, and we advertise these positions about once a year. We do a big call out, and then we're getting ready to do that. So when we get to, we're gonna kind of talk about the program and how it's set up and what the benefits are, and then Tony's gonna help you kind of understand how to get in your applications into the system. So basically, we have many, many fields of internships, and most of our interns are hired as engineers, scientists, business professionals, technical support, and logistical support. But our big thrust area, as Chris mentioned, we're looking for computer scientists and computer engineers. We cannot hire enough, and what we found is that we have a huge amount of success to have interns and become future employees to our engineering science development program, which they go into upon graduation. But if we can grow those employees, you have a tie to the area, you know where you're working, you know the workforce, your education's a little bit tailored towards the type of work that we do. So when you graduate and you become a professional engineer, computer scientist, or any of those fields, you basically hit the ground running. You get started a lot faster. It's less acclimation time for everyone involved. So we're really trying to grow our impact and really get students engaged and excited about our program from the get-go. So that's really why we're here today, is kind of share that experience with you. So we have two types of appointments under the intern program, and the appointments are basically the two different ways that you can be hired. We have permanent interns, which are for students that are a little bit further into their education plan. Like, you know for sure, I am going to become an electrical engineer, and I've enrolled in the program and everything like that. Those types of positions. And when you're a permanent intern, you basically get hired and you stay with the program, working off and on, coordinating all of that with your supervisor and everything, through your education plan up to graduation with your bachelor's degree. Those interns will leave and have benefits. They get all, you basically, you're treated like a federal employee. And it's a good opportunity for you to basically stay with the program. And another huge benefit that we have with the internship program, under these particular types of interns, is that we can help you with your tuition assistance, which is kind of a big deal. So we can pay up to the cost of a UC education year by year. And in exchange for that, we ask for a service agreement, which is essentially you're agreeing to work for us for a certain amount of years for every year that you are in the program under us in your education pay. So that's really the end goal of what we're trying to grow, is get people into this permanent internship program. But in order to get people ready for that and to understand if they're good for, it's a good fit for our organization and the career field that you guys are looking at, we have what we call summer interns, which the term is summer because mostly they hire in during the summertime frame. And they're basically a one-year appointment. So you're hired to work for us for a year, and sometimes it can be extended for another year. And it's sort of a trial period. The whole program is kind of set up as a trial period to become a federal employee. But the summer interns, you know, you sign up for a year, you get some experience and decide, you know, maybe it's not for me, but maybe it is, maybe it's a great fit. Those are the types of positions that we kind of try to filter into the permanent internships. As a summer intern, like I said, they're all paid. You get paid for every hour of work that you perform. We don't do unpaid internships. You still accrue leave and some limited benefits as a basically a term employee. And you still get the experience of being learning what your career fields are. What are the options out there for what you want to do? Is a position with the federal government a good fit for you? So those are the two types of interns that we have. And these are not necessarily limited to interns only in pursuit of their bachelor's degrees. We have students that are working up to their associates, and that's the career field that works for them. And they graduate as the associate's degree. We have students that are hired in, even in high school, and they graduate with their diploma and go into technical type education plans. And they are also able to be in the program and graduate and be successful employees for us. So it's not limited to just bachelor's programs. We understand that not everyone follows the same career path or same education plan. So we try to tailor to what's best suited for our needs and the workforce that we're bringing in. So are there any questions about those before I move on? Or if there are along the way, just throw your hand up. Yes.
Is it specifically geared towards computer science and mechanical engineering, or is there a civil engineering opportunities as well?
There are fewer civil engineering opportunities with our specific tenant, which is the weapons division of NOPWD. There are multiple tenants that work at Point Magoo, and some of them may be more focused in the civil engineering type program. But the program that I support is weapons division, and right now our big thrust is on computer scientists, computer engineers, and electrical engineers. But we do hire other engineers, just not as many of them. Yes?
Most of the students here are planning to transfer. Do you plan to keep in contact with us after we transfer to teach university?
Yeah, so I work for the professional recruitment offices, which is a subset of the HR group that we're here supporting. And we do a lot of on-campus recruitment, both in California and across the nation. So you will still hear from us, most likely if you transfer to a school local to this area, Santa Barbara, Cal Poly, either one of the Cal Polys, UCLA, anything like that. We also recruit on those campuses, so we're easy to find. And you don't have to stay here. If you are hired with us, it's not like, oh, you graduated Oxnard College and you're done. You can continue your education plan, and we support you through that, and then you continue to communicate with us as you finish your 4-year degree. Anything else? So we want to talk about eligibility requirements, which is kind of a big issue because it's really kind of complicated, especially with the way things are changing in the environment of the state. The first major requirement, because this is a student employment program, you do have to be a student. You have to be half-time enrolled in some kind of education institution. Obviously, that because you're all students here, really the biggest emphasis to remember is that you have to be half-time enrolled, and you have to be in good academic standing when you apply for your position, and that's something Tony can talk about a little bit in his section. So you don't necessarily have to say, I'm going to be an electrical engineer graduating on such and such date, but you do need to have kind of a general idea in order to make it through the eligibility criteria. You do need to have and maintain a 2.5 GPA. We understand that sometimes, maybe you have a little bit of a rough semester once you come aboard. If your GPA drops, and it's a cumulative GPA, not just by term, if it drops through there, we can help you kind of get yourself back on track. So we do give you a little bit of a chance to kind of get things going and get on the right track to graduate your program. You need to be a U.S. citizen at least 16 years old. We cannot hire somebody that's less than 16, but seeing as how we're at a community college, I think we're pretty clear on that, CritterNet age group. And you do need to be able to get a security clearance, which is kind of a big deal sort of thing. You cannot be an employee with the government if you don't have your security clearance, and there's a lot of factors that can play into that. You need to be mindful of your financial status. We can't really give clearances to someone who seems like they would be at risk financially. And it's not saying that you can't have a little bit of debt, but you do need to be kind of careful and not have a bunch of outstanding bills and things that aren't being paid. We want responsible people that are not going to be at risk for espionage, really, is what the whole point of that is. There's some other factors that lead to security clearances. Criminal history can be a bad working against someone. And the big issue is that you cannot violate federal laws that maybe the state does allow. I'm not really sure how to cover this topic delicately, but
we do drug testing and our folks, so a lot of misperception out there is because it's legalized in some states, Colorado, California, Washington, that it's okay, but we follow federal law on state property. So because it's still an illegal drug under federal law, we test, if we have folks who test positive, it's one of the quicker ways to lose your job. So,
okay, so those are the basic criteria. You have to be able to have clearance, you need to be at least 16 years old, half-time enrolled in an education program, and keep up your GPA. Sounds kind of simple, it does kind of build up to be a little more complex. Yes?
You mentioned the minimum requirements for a GPA, but what would you consider to be a competitive GPA to apply for your job?
We hire pretty much across the board. We obviously someone that has like a 4.0, 3.5, really at the higher end of the GPA scale, a manager, there's probably going to be a little more excitement from the managers. But really what they look at is the nature of the program that you're graduating from. We know that some programs are really, really complex, and to see a phenomenal GPA that there's somebody who can swipe them. But there's not anything that's really going to work against you, say you have like a 2.8 or a 3.2. It's not going to really change eligibility requirements so much for us, because we understand that education programs are hard, and they're meant to be challenging, and you can learn a lot. So we don't really kind of look against that unless we can see a GPA that's just barely clearing it every single time on your transcripts and it's coming. Is that really going to work out long term? Any other questions on that segment? So one of the big questions that I get about the internship program a lot is the type of work schedule. We have students that pretty much work full-time throughout the summer and on their school breaks, and then when they go away to school, they're done, and they turn in their badges. Supervisor kind of keeps them in mind for things, but they're not expected to work, and that's totally fine. That works for a lot of people. There are students that attend school online, or they attend locally, and they want to work throughout the year, and we also allow that as well. They work up to a full-time schedule, so there's not going to be a set schedule that comes with every position. It's a little bit of taking ownership of your career path and education plans and working that out with your supervisor. But there are options to work year-round, and there's options to work only when you're not in class. again, that's really decided on an individual basis. But what we want everyone to remember is that this is an education-based program, and that emphasis for everyone should always be on doing everything you can to do well in your education plan versus I need to work as many hours as possible. So that's definitely something that we want to have everyone keep in mind. So that's really the basis of how our program works and what we're looking for. So I kind of wanted to give everyone an overview and then see if there were any kind of questions that come up along the way. Actually, I missed something huge. So the benefits of one of the types of positions that we have, the permanent interns that I spoke about, the ones that are a little further in the education plan, when you graduate, you are eligible for what we call a non-competitive conversion to a career position, which basically means you're going from your sort of temporary student appointment into your career position where you start your real work with the government. And you do that without having to apply to any job postings. You don't have to go through the whole security review process again. Everything that takes a significant amount of time as an employee. It's a much quicker way to hire. It's part of a benefit of you worked with us, supported us, we supported you. We're going to make it a little bit easier on you to become a federal employee under a career appointment type of thing. So, yes.
Is there a big pool for aerospace majors?
I'm not going to say there's not a pool, but the focus is definitely on electrical and computer engineers. But we do have managers that are very specific aerospace and aeronautical, and they kind of look more towards the flight testing engineer type programs, and we can actually talk about that a little bit more later on, but there is definitely a pool for that. I mean, the top probably five types of engineers that we pick up are electrical, computer, mechanical, there's some civils in there, not a whole lot, and then aerospace is probably one of the top five. And we definitely recruited schools that do specialize in more of the aeronautical and aerospace type degrees. It's just a little bit more narrow type of work that they do. But again, what happens when you become an employee in the ESDP, which is our Engineering Science Development Program, is that you come aboard at any type of basically degree that gets you into the program, and you rotate through the positions. So you have a year of touring where you can kind of float around and find the home that's best for you in your career path and your degree and everything, and then they'll find a fit and then teach you how to be the engineer that we need for the command. So there are some benefits to that. That's the whole selling point of the ESDP, is that there are touring, and my program is designed to kind of make that feeder pool to that type of position. Yes?
I have a question. So just because you're saying that you're mostly looking for electrical engineering major, if, for example, I'm a mechanical engineering major, so I'm still encouraged to go ahead and apply.
Right. And so it's not to say that we're not hiring any other types of positions. Our big thrust is looking for computer scientists, computer engineers, electricals. We do have a vast majority. I mean, mechanicals are probably right up there. Not as many, but they're pretty highly competitive positions. So we are definitely not wanting to discourage mechanical engineers or aero engineers. Like I said, civil's a little bit harder because it's a little more narrow career field that's more towards the facilities and type support that we do. But we do hire a significant number of mechanicals as well.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Yes.
You mentioned a lot of after you earn a bachelor's opportunities, and say if the student wants to go to graduate school, to the education through that.
So we have fewer graduate students in the Pathways program, but we do have them that are up at that level. What tends to happen is they go into the ESDP, they come in as a bachelor, and then they go on to get their graduate degrees after they have a little time in the program, and they become eligible for our Commands Fellowship program, which is where they pay for your furthering education, they pay for you to go to school and your time while you're at school. So we do hire people that have master's degrees into the ESDP, and we do it probably about a quarter of the workforce that we pick up. But what a lot of them have started doing lately is graduating for bachelor's, working for a little bit, becoming eligible for the fellowship program, and then getting their degrees paid for that way as well. But we can't hire bachelor's and master's for ESDP. Yes.
Do you know if the money that this program provides for the student to go to school is accounted for on the FAFSA.
I don't know. I don't know how that works out because I have students that are supported by us, so we provide different levels of support. I have some that are on their GI Bill, and then we're covering whatever doesn't happen to be covered. I have some that are receiving grants from the state, and then we become secondary. And I don't know how that gets reported on the FAFSA, but I can look into that. That's actually a really good question. I'm
talking about the students.
Yeah.
Because you don't have to. Okay. You don't report the tuition assistance or the investment. It's separate.
Any other questions? So what I'm going to do is kind of let you guys marinate on that a little bit, and we'll turn it over to Tony. He's going to kind of talk about how you can get into the system and apply for these types of positions. And then we'll wrap up and see if we have some more questions and have some more discussion about how these programs might work out for you. Thank you.
I'm Tony Street. I'm a human resources specialist at Mount WD. I actually started off as a pathways intern. I've been in the same seat you guys have been in, learning about internships. I actually got my internship when I was in grad school. And I was running out of GI Bill money. I was a veteran, and it was a really great opportunity to get an internship. I actually used some of the tuition assistance to pay for some of my school, and it's just a great opportunity. One of the things you're probably wondering is how do I apply for these positions and where do I look for them? It's a little different than applying for other jobs. You're going to go. I don't know if everybody has one of these flyers. You don't. I can provide one for you. Oh, you got one? Okay. So you're going to want to open up, this kind of walks you through applying for the jobs. You can actually look for jobs without applying, without registering, but I strongly recommend creating a profile first, because sometimes when you see you go to search for jobs there, you may think, like, okay, it closes tomorrow. It's always good to have a profile. So the first thing you're going to want to do is to create an account, and that's going to be all your personal information and your name, all that stuff. And then after that, you're going to edit the profile based on your location, because you can put different locations in there. You're going to want to do the area, specifically if you're applying for a position at Point of View with us. Then you're going to want to upload your resume or build a resume. I strongly recommend building a resume because it puts them in the format that we need for hiring. And that's for any federal job you're going to apply for through USA Jobs. So when you're building a resume on USA Jobs, you're going to want to be very specific on what you've done. I don't know if you've had any other experience doing with any other internships, but you want to be as specific as possible. It's not like any other resume where you're just putting bullets. You want to be as specific as possible so you can qualify for positions. Question?
What would you recommend putting on a resume to make the system recognize it and make it more competitive?
Just being specific on what your experience is. As a student, you're going to want to, if you've worked on anything, what you're studying, just be very specific. There's no limit on how much you put in there, so just take that into consideration when you're building your resume on there. The classes, the projects you've worked on in the class. One thing you're going to want to make sure whenever you do transfer from here to a four-year university, you want to make sure that you go, you pick an ABET qualified school, because that's going to be contingent on getting hired also as an engineer or scientist, being an ABET qualified program. So. Let's see. So when you build your resume, you can actually build up to five different resumes. You can have five different resumes on your profile. So let's say you're studying aeronautical engineering, but you also want to apply for different types of positions. You can put five different ones on there. So when you do see a position that opens, let's say it's a pathways position, it may not be specific to aeronautical engineering, but you've taken classes in this. You can put that different resume and you can upload that. to the announcement. So once you build your resume, build a few resumes on there, you're going to want to actually make sure, I don't know if we have any veterans here. Any veterans? Yeah. You can put your any form that you have, DD-214. If you've ever worked for the government, you can put your form, it's called Standard Form 50. Anything like that, you're going to want to upload any documents so you can have them on file for when you see those positions open. Yeah, it's important to have all those on. Whenever you do apply for jobs, you're going to want to make sure that you look at what's required. What required documents are needed. You may need to have your unofficial transcripts on there if you're still in school, or once you finish school, you're going to want to have your official transcripts ready to pass on to the HR specialist. Any questions on that so far? Okay. All right. So specifically, when you go on USA Jobs, you can actually do standard search whenever you're looking for any jobs, or you can do an advanced search and actually put more information. Like on the handout, it says that you can put NAVAIR, and it would be specific to our organization. But you can put you can put the series you want if you can figure that out. Most of those series for pathways have the 99 at the end, so we have 899, 1599 for different positions. So you can put the range depending on where you are in your educational process, depending on the units. She talked about temporary and permanent. A couple of tips, always to have any updated information. Update your profile as like you move somewhere, just so you have it updated whenever you apply for a position. You don't want the wrong information on there and being disqualified for that reason, and having uploading the documents that are required. Any questions about applying for positions or anything else? Okay. I think we're going to open it up.
How often do internship positions open up on Pathways? And when you have people looking up?
Right. So our Pathways announcements for this year should be coming out maybe in 2 weeks. They don't really stay open very long. So I highly recommend building a profile in USA Jobs if you're interested in this opportunity, and getting all that information in there, because I mean you could catch it, like, I don't know how often you would look, but you can catch it 2 days before it ends, and you have a hard time getting all that information. So they don't stay open very long, probably like a week, 2 weeks, 2 weeks. I actually came on at a different time. It was a different Pathways announcements, but normally once a year, and it's at the beginning of the year. It's this time of year. So. Yes, you can do that. You can have a, I think it's the RSS search, to where it sends you the feeds whenever there's a certain type of announcement that comes up in the area. There's more specifics on that when you log in to USA Jobs. But yeah, you can have them send you information. Once you apply for jobs, they actually give you information on when you can request to have information when the job closes. And if you're selected, you get emails. The main thing to remember is that it may go to your spam box, so check all that when applying for any job. Your spam box. So. Any other questions? Yes.
Nick, since you are here representing Point of View, we're going to be working on Point of View base.
So it's not WD. It's Warfare Center Weapons Division. So we have Point of View, but we also have. Angel was talking about China Lake. There's opportunities there also. But I mean, I know you guys are here locally going to school, so there's good opportunities at both, but we're all the same organization. So.
Yeah, that's one thing I forgot to cover that I wanted to in the beginning is you probably have heard MBDC the Naval Base Ventura County. So that's a conglomerate of Fort Wayne Navy and Point Lagoon. And they're the landlord. They are responsible for maintaining facilities on base, providing fire services, law enforcement. So we basically say roads and promotes. They're the landlord of the base. But there's 70 tenant activities at Fort Wayne Indian Point of View. So the major tenant activities are where we work at Point Purdue, the Naval or Warfare Center Weapons Division. So we say NOC-WD. At Wainimi, you have Naval Facility Construction Center. So there's a NAVFAC facility. So if you're a civilian engineer, that's a place you want to go work because they deal with naval facility issues worldwide. And then there's a NAVC, which is the Naval Sea Warfare Center. So they're like us, they're a warfare center, but they deal with ships. So there are 2,000 employees over at NAVC Fort Wainimi. We have 1,500 employees at NOC-WD at Point Purdue. And then we have 4,000 employees up at China Lake, which is part of the weapons division complex because we're geographically separated by the desert. If you're going to San Diego for school, there's a boatload of commands down in San Diego. There's a Space and Warfare Command. There's an air station at Coronado. There's a naval station at the Bay. So there's just a wealth of opportunity to go if you want to go work for the Navy. You know, we're interested in candidates. We're interested in qualified candidates for the Weapons Division for the Warfare Center. But there's a lot of different jobs available for the Navy, either in this area and San Diego as well. So yeah, don't limit yourself to necessarily looking at jobs at Point Purdue. Like Tony said, if you have a chance to build profiles or do job searches, look for positions open at Wainimi as well, and San Diego area is fairly local. Or if you're going to school somewhere, some other location where there may be opportunities to go with the Navy.
I think I just wanted to add one more thing. As a Pathways intern, this opportunity, I think it's really good. I talked to a lot of people at career fairs, and they're like, oh, as a student, what should I do? And it's like, when HR specialists look at resumes and they see that experience that you had in the summertime or while you were in college, it really makes a difference. Pathways intern, you're working on something specific. They see resumes all the time and it's like Starbucks, I was a surf instructor, I was a lifeguard. This makes you so much more competitive. So I wish someone would have told me that when I was in community college to make myself more competitive when I graduated. So that's the last thing. Yes.
How many students apply for these positions? Because how many people actually get in?
So we had about 600 applicants across both sites last year. And one of the things to remember is the number's going to sound really low when I say it, but we picked up, I think for the last 3 years at Point Purdue, we've picked up about 45 total interns. Some of them have renewed their appointments, some of them are brand new. But what's happening is that this program for Pathways is actually only a couple of years old, and when it did become released in 2012, we immediately went into a hiring freeze and we couldn't hire anyone, so the program's just now picking up speed. The managers at Point Purdue have become really excited and engaged in the program and understanding how this opportunity can help them grow their workforce. So we're expecting to see bigger numbers, but we don't know exactly how many that's going to be quite yet. The numbers tend to vary based upon the number of candidates, the quality of the candidates that they're finding based upon that resumes that we receive. So it's really hard to nail that number down, but what is important to know is that the program has a lot of support from our hiring team, and we're just really looking for the best quality candidates that we can find.
Any other questions? Overall, any other questions?
Well, you said that you're here to advertise like the open application for positions, right?
Yes.
Is there like a certain notification or section on USA Jobs Issues that says that specifically?
So the positions are generally advertised as DON student trainee, or the subject will say DON, which is Department of Navy, DON Pathways intern, and then in parenthetical, it will tell the type of intern that it is, computer scientist, engineer, and they do all engineers as one batch. Anyone that's in a computer science or related degree, all as one batch. There's even a very small handful of like administrative support, it will say clerical or admin or procurement technician, things like that. But generally, they're advertised as DON, Pathways intern, DON student trainee, and so that's what you would want to put in your search criteria in the the mode that Tony was explaining for your RSS search option.
Yeah, not to get too far down in the weeds, but our HR backroom services are processed in Philadelphia. So Angels in China Lake, we're at Point Padue. We're dealing with people in Philadelphia that work for the Navy, and so that's where the resumes go. They're screened, they're processed. What Angel receives is a list of potential candidates that are found qualified. And we provide that to our hiring managers, and with an advertisement in late January, we're probably not seeing that list until mid-March. And then we're making selections and going through the pre-paperwork, security reviews, and trying to get candidates on by the end of the school year, early June if possible. So it's kind of just the timeline we're working with here. Is there a question?
What's an example of the work contract time? Like, if you're, say you get tuition assistance for 4 years or something, then are you're locked into more time to work for the company for, is it compounding each year that you get assistance?
Yes. So you'll, for every year that we pay, a full year is considered two terms, then you are considered owing us 2 years of service.
It's a service agreement.
So you would, what we generally do is we start covering education in about the junior year. So they're basically earning up to 4 years of service to us. But the way our ESDP program is designed, it's a 3 to 5 year program. 3 years of the master's, 4 years of the bachelor's, or I'm sorry, 5 years of the bachelor's. So you are done with your service time owed to us before you're done with your ESDP, your developmental program that's taking you up to the journey level, engineer, scientist, or whatever your field is. So we're basically kind of just ensuring that we're building a workforce that wants to stay with us through the majority of that program. What we find is that once you get through those first couple of years working with us, whether you relocate to a different area or you found a home with a new code or whatever you're doing as an employee, you get through those first couple of years, people tend to stay. That's where the retention starts to build up and people are invested in what they're doing and where they're at. So that's kind of how we're growing our employees. Long-term career professionals. But it is 2 years for everyone here.
Yeah, as more specifically, because you came from the internship program, what's the company culture at these different positions? Is it a really positive working environment?
Oh, it's very positive.
I know different companies have different people,
but
it's huge now.
The way I felt as an intern, it was very positive. It was very, I was in an area where there weren't other interns. So I felt like I was given a lot of knowledge. Because I was expected to be there for the long term, and I am. I'm still after an intern. I got a lot of input. It was very, I think the culture was very good, and it's helpful to me going to school also. So I would get time off to be able to go to class, and it cost me that. So.
So to add to that, our program isn't designed as what may be more of a commercial internship, where they're bringing in 100 people looking for one, and we're going to cut everyone else off. Our program isn't done like that. Everyone that we bring aboard is somebody that we hope to make a career employee out of. So it is our best interest as weapons division to provide the most positive experience, and our managers have a little bit of an obligation to help the students figure out, is this really what I want to do, or maybe I'm a better fit with this part of the organization, or this is my better career path. They're helpful in that way, and they're very supportive of it, but it's not a, fit for yourself, survival of the fittest type of internship.
But one of the things our mantra is we support war fighters. So a lot of the work that's done at China Lake, a lot of the work that's done at Point Padue is direct support to the fleet, the war fighter. So things we're doing out there are things that are being introduced in conflict worldwide. Did anybody watch 60 Minutes last Sunday? Yeah, we had a program, a 20-minute program. 60 Minutes, and part of that was filmed at China Lake because of the developmental work they're doing with MIT and Livingston Laboratory out of MIT. So some of the stuff we do, a lot of the stuff we do is cutting edge. You won't find it being done anywhere else. You won't find it being done in private industry. So it's, to me, I've worked there for over 30 years. It's really meaningful to me that, you know, I have a purpose. I'm not a veteran like Tony. I didn't have the honor of wearing a uniform, but I like the fact that the work I'm doing does support, in some way, maybe not directly, but indirectly, the War Affairs Office. So you'll find that in any office, any location, any Navy facility. You'll find that kind of spirit, that culture there.
Thank you.
This is for you, Tony. Like, in pride as an intern, what are some of the expectations as an intern?
Well, I think the main expectation is that one of the main things I found was doing your part with school, like keeping your grades at the level that's specified in the program. And really, I had a developmental program that I had a developmental plan that I needed to stay part on. And it really, it was based on how much school I had left, and I think staying on that plan. And it was laid out for me. You know, I sat down with my boss and we went over the plan. But the expectation, I think, at the level you're at would be, you know, your grades, sticking with the grades and the amount of any type of training that they would need, that you would need to go through. Yeah. So.
And you also get exposed to the actual work out there. You get connected with a mentor, somebody who's more experienced engineer, and you get exposed to the actual work out there. So what then?
Trying to figure out where ability suffered my biggest issue is just timing and scheduling. So right now I can already tell you I'm blocked, that I'm not around. I'd love to do this program, but how much flexibility do we have in scheduling? I'm booked out through office right now. So it seems, I think I can't do it. I'd love to have it on my resume, but how do I make that happen? Does that make sense?
Well, we do have positions with, like I mentioned, that they're kind of more of a year-round. It is limited based upon, of course, if you're going away to school somewhere, you can't also be working and being two places at once. But students that are local or tend to be going to school online, they do work up to year-round and they take some time off to do whatever it is that they need to do. I have permanent interns who we've had with us for the majority of their education, and say the summer before their senior year, that one of them went off and did an external internship while still maintaining their employment with us. Because it was unpaid, they were able to do that other option. He discovered that working in the private sector is not for him. That what he had been working for all of his education plans, what he wanted to do, he graduated, he became an ESCP very recently with us. He was very happy with that career plan. So there is some flexibility, but he was also one that worked on school breaks and then went away for the years and then took that section of time off. So we have the option to support other, maybe a little more alternative education plans, but you know, it's variable based on the manager and what they can support, what the workload requirements are. We're limited by funding, where these positions are not paid for out of any kind of command overhead pot. We have customers and support that is paying for these positions, that's paying your salary. So it is very unique, but that's not to say that we only offer positions from like May to September.
So my best bet would be to just filter through and look for positions that are part-time, or how would I get into the system if that's this summer, and I know my summer is all crazy already, and I just say, I'm gonna do it next year and just write it off, or is there some step I could take to get into the system?
There may be, like I said, I don't have a specific number of exact requirements that our hiring managers want for exact periods of time. I would say go ahead and get your resume in there, get in the queue. And what happens, as Chris mentioned, the certs come back to me, which is basically a list of names. And I upload those resumes into a SharePoint. Our managers go through and make their selection from there. They're on their own. I don't tell them, you need this candidate, you need this candidate.
Sure.
They talk to them, they interview them and decide, well, what are your requirements? You know, is it a good fit? Maybe it's a different fit for somebody else. So I don't think there's any harm in getting in there and seeing if you can find a home with someone else. And if it doesn't work this summer, then we are going to be here, you know, assuming everything's out.
In your system.
Well, no, when, once the cert closes, we're kind of done with that, and then we'll do this again, but this is an annual requirement. And then there are some one-off positions that come up on USA Jobs. A customer has a specific requirement, and say, all of my interns left, and I need someone in October.
Sure.
That can come up too, and it's just based upon the needs of what our customer needs, our work of work fire needs from us.
Yes.
Is there any courses or jobs in the drone program, which is something that should be coming up for the future?
We have some customers that they support the unmanned system types of activities. I don't know enough to really speak intelligently about specific programs and the what they're flying, what they're doing, what they're developing. But that is a major focus of our command, and so there is a lot of work that does support that. Any other questions?
As far as salary goes, is that a set salary for every single person that gets brought in?
It is set based upon your education units. So there's one for students that are in high school, one from graduating up to completing 30 units. When you become 30 units, that's another GS grade that you move up. And then everyone that's completed 60 units or more than that are at what we call the GS4 in the salary grade. And then you're within that band of salary.
Yes. And would it be at the time of applying, you'd say 60 units, because you'd be hiring for the summer, right? So
yes, so we would be looking at what you would have when you come aboard. So if you say currently at 45, but you're taking 15 units and you're going to complete those units before we actually bring you in, we would most likely have your salary set at 15 units. Salary.
Yeah, we'll be around for a while, so if you have a question you want to come up, talk to us one on one, yeah, we'll be here. So really, this is a fantastic turnout. We thought we'd get 20 or 30 students. We almost didn't we canceled this initially, so I'm glad we got it back on track. And yeah, thank you all for showing up and taking the time to.